And here he is. You wish it, and Artie Lange is in the studio. Wow.
Hey, Steve. How you doing, pal?
Good. Rachel, you've come back.
Yeah, you know what's funny about that? You hear in the background my mother cooking a mozzarella omelet. She was laughing at the military service line. Technology is something. When I was screwed up, I never really embraced how much fun you could have, and I just thought, you know, it'd be fun to put out a movie quote every day. So I did a little Animal House.
You do it really well, though. Yeah. I mean, you get into the role. Some people just do it. You act it out.
Yeah, that is why I didn't go to law school, because all that was in my head. I filled up my head with useless stuff I thought was useless, and then I got the one job where I need to use it. But yeah, that's a classic of all classics.
So how you doing? How you feeling? It's so great to have you in here, man. From
Steve,
the last time,
I love you, buddy. You've been so nice to me over the past few years. I feel fantastic. You know, I got 8 months clean next week.
Right.
You know, it's been a long road. Our friend Kevin Mira helped me get into the retreat. The retreat got me off of heroin. And then this last go round, I went to a place called Turning Point in Patterson this last 3 months. And they helped me get off everything else, you know, a combination of those two amazing places. But I really got to give props to Turning Point in Patterson. I was there for 3 months. My counselor, Sarah, there's a guy named Bugs there who's a guy who's like called a counselor aide, who helped save my life. So I feel fantastic. Props to Turning Point, and I'm alive.
Yeah,
I'm still here.
Absolutely.
I'm going to be 52 in a few weeks, bro.
You believe that?
No, I don't believe that. That's insane.
Yeah. Well, first off, I got to thank you for coming here to New Jersey 101.5. Artie, you could have gone anywhere. And the fact that you came here means so much.
Well, listen, Steve, I love you, and I love the show. And like I said, you know, I had a busy day. I got to be in probation tomorrow at 9 o'clock, but I said I'm going to drive down here because I love you guys so much. So it's good to be here.
We really appreciate it. Now, I got to ask you, though, what are you doing this time that's going to make the rehab work?
Well, I got to tell you, first of all, I have more consequences in my life than I've ever had before. Now, if I screw up this time, you know, there's jail involved. Like, I mean, I've been going to jail since the '80s, on and off. But now, I mean, at 52 years old, I'm as the young kids say, I'm not beat for that anymore. I don't feel like seeing my mom upset anymore. I got great friends. My career somehow, I mean, I say it all the time. You know, 3 fiancés left me because of drugs. Drugs saved me a lot of money. The divorces would have been way more expensive than the drugs. But now it's like enough already, man. I got to try to. Comedy is the one thing. People like you and my career and my fans are the one thing that has not abandoned me. And I got to start being grateful for that. Show some gratitude and do this the right way. You know,
there's so many people that love you. You know, and you know that. I mean, I've been on the road. I've seen people run up to you crying. I hear about Artie, take this medal and all
that.
You know, but like if you really Artie's friend now, and we all love Artie, you don't give Artie a drink. Right? You don't give Artie a joint. You don't give him crack. You don't give him heroin.
Well, you know, I got to tell you, I appreciate you saying that. But, you know, you got to take responsibility for yourself as an adult. Over the years, I you know, you could say no to that stuff. I always tell you, the devil is not going to look like me with cocaine. The devil's going to look like a hot chick with cocaine. That's what the devil looks like. There's a lot of guys dead and in jail because of women. There's a lot of predators out there. But, you know, you got to be strong. I'm an adult. I can say no to stuff. I'm not one of these drug addicts that blames everybody around them for their problems. I got to be strong and do what I got to do, you know.
Well, you know, we're going to have to do the traffic pretty soon.
Of course. Traffic is one of my favorite things about the Steve Trevelise Show.
Hang out. We'll be right back. Yeah. He said he was going to be here. And Artie Lange says he's going to be somewhere.
The new Artie Lange. Yeah, right.
Man, this is a totally different Artie Lange. Not that you were hysterical the last time, but look at you. You're all happy and cheery.
Happy and cheery is a new thing.
Yeah.
It's funny. My hair went, I was always getting gray, but my hair went gray, man. And I don't care. I'm not going to be one of those guys that's like, you know, like Bob Levy with the jet black hair. Nick DiPaolo had a great joke about Bob, where because Bob had Richard Nixon's neck. an old person's neck and jet black hair. And he said, if you have somebody to guess your age and their first guess is 72 and their second is 28, you know, something. You look at your neck at 72, your hair at 28. Bob pulls it off. He looks kind of cool, but I don't think I could do that. So I left it all white. I mean, I look ancient. I finally got the kind of hair I could hide cocaine in. I got the right color. and now I stopped doing it.
And you're keeping the nose too, right?
Well, you know, it's funny. I have a couple of offers from TV shows to fix my nose on television. And I don't know. I'll get to that when I can. I can breathe out of my nose. But like I said in a couple of interviews, it's a total reminder of the craziness of my life. When I look in the mirror, and I would tell young kids in rehab, I went to rehab with a lot of young kids whose lives are in shambles because of drug abuse. I mean, either selling dope or blow or doing it. And they're 22 years old. They're living under a bridge. They're looking at prison time. Their families won't talk to them. And again, it's just they suffer from, you want to call it a disease, whatever. They suffer from this thing, whether either addicted to quick money or a high. And I would tell them, look at me, guys. I would say to these kids, I'm 30 years older than you. I'm still in jail. I'm still in rehab. Look at this nose, bro. You know what I mean? I mean, look at me. I look like a boxer. I never boxed in my life. It's a fight you're in. I would tell these kids, it's a fight for your life. You don't want to be old. And they, a lot of them looked up to me. They would say, you know, because I had success in life. There was a TV in the back of the rehab I was just in Patterson, where these kids, you know, they could do anything, these kids, with a phone. They come out of the womb, they know how to work like YouTube and stuff. So they would find all my stand-up on YouTube. They'd see stuff on Stern and the movies I did. They would watch them, and then they talked to me. A couple of them had my books, and they said, well, you had so much success in life, and how'd you do that? And I said, well, you know, you should definitely look up to people who have had success like me, but look at my failures. You know, look at what I think I could have been so much more. They respect the fact that I'm somewhat famous.
Right.
But I said, look at what I did wrong, guys, and don't do that, you know.
So, no, it's, you know what? It's a great way to look at it. You know, my son's at 12. They see the funny stuff.
Yeah, right.
Showed him Dirty Work.
Yeah. Dirty Work's PG-13.
I just got to the edge there.
Right.
But
right.
You care so much. I mean, it's the one thing about you. No matter what you went through, you always worry, how's Bob doing? How's this one doing? Yeah, how's that one doing? You know, you don't worry about yourself as much as you worry about other people. You seriously do have such a big heart when it comes to that.
Thank you. But, you know, again, I just think it's like the, you know, the It's a Wonderful Life thing. Hey, Kevin Barrett, there he is.
There he is, Jimmy Stewart, right here. It's a Wonderful Life.
Good to see you.
Kevin Mirrors, City of Angels in the house.
I got to say something about Kevin. Uh-huh. Like I said, I was in rehab in Patterson, New Jersey. Great place, turning point. I give it a bunch of props. But there was a lot of kids from the Hamilton area, a lot of kids from Trenton, a lot of kids from South Jersey. They all know Kevin. They all love him. They all love him. They're like anybody. When you bring, they say, they would tell me, you know, because in rehab, the place I was in, there was 80 guys on like a hospital floor. And when you have a smoke break, everybody's out there. You get smoke break therapy. And you get a lot out of talking to fellow addicts about their experience, where you're from type of thing. They would say, a couple guys said Hamilton, that area. And I would ask about Kevin. They go, oh, yeah, Kevin, City of Angels, we love him. They know how great of a guy he is. So you're loved, buddy.
See that? You are loved. He tells me that every day. I get a text. I am loved. That's how I know.
But
you better remember.
It's
he reminds
it's like
us.
These, these young,
now you got witness back.
These young hip hop kids. Like, yo, man, yeah, Kev's like my OG, man. Kev's a good man, man.
Now, I know you're telling the truth about the guys from Hamilton, because one of our guys, Chris, came home. He was all excited. He said, oh, I met Artie Lange.
You were telling me that today.
Hey, all right, hold up. How's your recovery?
Right.
Oh, yeah, by the way. All right, listen, we got to take a break. When we come back, we got Artie Lange here. You're going to hang out tonight, right?
Yeah, I'll be around.
All right, we're going to do fun things. Like I said, it is so good. I've never heard you this good. You are so happy. You are cheery. Look at you.
My mother, you know, not an educated woman, didn't get far in school, but she's insanely intelligent, my mom. She says deep stuff. Mm-hmm. And she the first time she came to visit me in rehab after, you know, I was in county jail for 2 months. I was in a crazy halfway house for 3 months. And then when she first came to visit me in this last rehab, she said, I haven't seen you in so long. And I said, Ma, I just saw you a month ago. You came to visit me. She goes, no, I haven't seen this you in 30 years.
Wow.
You know, that hit me. that hit me hard, you know, because I'm lucid more, you know. And again, I, you know, the luck thing, I shouldn't be around, man. I went through a lot of craziness. You know, I wrote a fourth book in jail, a rough draft that I'm going to, you know, eventually get published. It seems it's called Ripping and Running, Life on Drug Court. And I'm telling stories I never told before. Like, there's stuff I lived through that I should not be here. I really should. I mean, I got somebody watching out for me.
Now, I was going to ask you that. Like, the Beatles went to India, came back with the White Album. Yeah. You go to rehab. You must have come back with a novel.
No, I got to tell you. I'll tell you this story about, you know, they tell you to hopefully have like a spiritual awakening of some sort. My old man was a big fan of the magician Houdini. And Houdini had a thing with his wife. His big thing, he wanted to debunk psychics. Right. And he had a thing with his wife where he said, when I die, we're going to have a secret word that just you and I know. And if you go to a psychic and the psychic tells you that word, he's really talking to me from beyond. Now, she tried, 50 years after his death, she tried to go to psychics. The guy, no one ever told her the word. And I don't know what the word was, but my old man was about to die, and he kind of knew it. We were talking, and he said, why don't we have a word, me and my dad? Right. And like a secret word that if you ever see this word, you'll know I'm talking to you, and I'm watching out for you. So his father worked at Otis Elevator in Newark. He was a factory worker. So he said, I said, why don't we make the word Otis? Like, if I see Otis, you know, you're in my life. So in the last 30 years since he's been dead, the word Otis is, I've seen it every once in a while, but nothing really where I go, wow, that's really like he's talking to me. So this last time I come out of jail and I go into a rehab, I got 5 months clean, and I really feel like I'm getting this. And I meet a guy at the rehab, and he says, I won't tell you how I met him, it's a long story, but he said, you know, Artie, I knew your dad. And we're just talking. And he goes, really? He had just got out of prison. And he goes, yeah, I knew your father. And, you know, your father hated drugs. Your father was a crazy guy, but he hated drugs. And he would hate that you would become a drug addict, but he would love that you're getting better. And he goes, I love seeing you. He was crying. He said, it's almost like I'm talking to you for your dad. And he hugged me and he goes, he would love that you're getting better. Please do this for your dad. And I said, that's amazing. So I get to know him a little bit. And I said, what prison did you just get out of? And I swear to you, he said, Otisville.
Oh, my God.
He said Otisville.
Wow.
And I, Steve, I'm going to tell you something. I got taken aback. Like, he said, he saw I was visibly like, what's wrong? And I said, I told him that story and he started to cry. Like, I said, that is the single most spiritual thing. That, not just Otis, like Otisville.
Yeah.
Like a land of Otis.
The whole.
Which is a federal prison, Otisville. Uh-huh. And the guy said, I just got out of Otisville. And I said, that's got it. If that's not my dad, he said to me before he said that, he goes, it's like I'm talking to you through your father. And he said, your father would want you to get better. And then he tells me he just got out of Otisville.
That is amazing. You get choked up hearing that.
No, is that crazy or what?
You keep the connection with this guy.
I have his number and I'm going to talk to him, but I want to get into details, but it's a long story. He's doing better, but that's what I've been going through. Like stuff like that has been happening to me a little bit, I just went to do my first stand up on the road, and I was nervous going back into it. I pull into the Tropicana where I'm doing my gig in Atlantic City, and the first I took a picture of it. The first thing I see is an Otis elevator truck. I swear to God, it said Otis on the, and I sent it to my mother.
Now you see him, now you're feeling him everywhere.
Well, no, now it's like get the hell out of my way.
Look, it's Otis Day in the Night. So, Artie, let's go check in.
Yeah, there you
check
go.
Check him out.
There you go. Animal House. So I don't know, man. If that, I mean, I'm not Mr. God, but that's nuts.
That's an experience. Yeah. That's a revelation.
Yeah.
Speaking of revelations, we have a little not a blast from your past, or maybe a blast from your past. Right. Do you remember Nick Ferroni from Union High School?
Of course.
He calls to say hi.
Of course.
Hey, Nick.
Artie, how are you?
Hey, Nick. How you doing, pal?
I'm really, really good. I'm so happy to obviously talk to you and see how you're doing. I just wanted to tell you, I don't think he knows this, Steve, but whenever I give any lectures on speaking or talking to teachers about how to inspire students, I always bring up Artie and Ed Wazizak.
Ah, yeah, Mr. Wazizak, my seventh grade social studies teacher. It was a great one. I hope, I don't know if he's still around. I had him on my old DirecTV show.
Absolutely, he's still around.
Yeah, yeah. He was, you know, some teachers, they don't influence you at all. He really embraced, every other teacher would kick me out, give me detention, I get suspended. Right. He said, I know how to take this energy I had in my humor and use it to make me learn and other people learn.
And it worked out for you.
And he's also the football coach of my junior high, an amazing guy. Well, thanks, Nick. Well, yeah, that's great.
Anytime I speak, I always say how it's like some perceived misbehaviors are a student's greatest asset. I always tell the story about how Ed Wazizak inspired me to become a history teacher, and he obviously was one of the few teachers who kind of supported your talents and
yes.
your skills and kind of gave you that platform.
It's funny,
so,
Nick.
Kind of perception.
It's funny, Nick called in. So listen to this. So about this rehab I was just in, I was there for 3 months, so a lot of stuff happened. We're watching, they would put New Jersey 12 News on.
Right.
Nick, I swear this happened. So we're watching New Jersey 12 News in the morning, me and 80 convicted felon drug addicts. All right, before breakfast.
Usual demo.
And there's Nick. Nick's on TV. Sexiest teacher in New Jersey. I said, I know that guy.
Everybody wanted to hang with you.
Yeah. They said, well, you know the sexiest teacher in the room. Yeah, Nick. So I saw that. That was like a couple of months ago or something.
Yeah. I was doing a campaign I did a campaign called No Summers Off to show that teachers work multiple jobs over the summertime.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Hey, we got to get Artie in the Union High Hall of Fame. How do we do that?
Now, just so you know, I'm officially in charge of the Union High Hall of Fame.
Are you serious?
Wow. Hey, yeah, I got an in.
Artie, you're my priority, and you're going to be the first person that I put in, and I get in.
There you go.
What would they name at the school after Artie? What would they name?
I think a urinal. I think that
and the plaque has to be eye level.
Artie Lange smoked weed here.
Artie, I'm sure they're the same urinals, I hate to say.
Yeah, I'm sure they are. I hope they change the ice. But that's great, Nick. Let me know. I'll get my speech ready.
I would love to see you either way, but I definitely will. And Steve, we're going to work on that.
You got it, pal. Absolutely.
Have a great night.
Guys. All right, Nick. Good talking to you.
Thanks for calling, New Jersey 101.5. All right, we got about 2 minutes, but real fast, Chris has been waiting to talk to you. And she's a huge fan. How you doing, Chris?
I'm doing well. Can you hear me okay?
We hear you.
Okay. So in 2009, Artie, you played the Masonic Center in San Francisco. My brother was in charge of security there, and he knew Sequoia. And we own a liquor store in Lavalette, and my brother was like, hey, send some stuff for Artie. You know, he loved being a Jersey.
Right.
So I sent it out. It cost us like $100 to send it out, right?
Right, right.
So we sent it out. Say to my brother, I was like, dude, like, did you meet Artie? How'd it go? He was like, I don't know. I know it got in his room. But he was sort of a chucklehead like you are.
Right.
So anyway, so my brother unexpectedly passed away in September of 2012, like a month before we were devastated with Andy, right? So anyway, I always thought, I was like, you know, I can't believe you didn't even meet him. You don't even talk to him. You didn't even talk to him about the liquor store. Right. So January 1st of 2015, you posted a photo on Facebook of you and Robin Quivers, and you were wearing our liquor store shirt. And I can't thank you for not dying, because you gave me a sign that my brother, you know, I wasn't the chucklehead you thought I was. See, he got your stuff, you know. And
yeah.
I just want to thank you for that. I want to thank you for that. So,
wow.
And it takes 5 years. I talked to Goose, and I was trying to get Goose to tell you. I sent a letter to Steve to let you know, and I just want to thank you for that.
You got to tell him yourself, Chris.
Again, let me tell you something. Spirituality, that is, it's funny. I played a lot of gigs in San Francisco. I can remember the gig she's talking about. It was 3,000 people sold out. It was the biggest gig I ever did in San Francisco, and I stay at the Mandarin Oriental Hotel when I'm out there.
Mm-hmm.
And it must have gotten my room, and I tried. If anybody ever sent me like a local business, especially Jersey, like I would get it all over the country, I would try to wear the shirt. And I'm glad. I'm so happy. I'm glad you saw that, Chris.
What a good guy. I 1-800-283-101.5. Artie Lange in the house. Here's New Jersey 101.5 Fast Traffic. Artie Lange in studio. I think he went outside for a smoke, Kevin Mira.
Here.
So can you believe how good he looks?
Yeah, he's doing great, isn't it? And they say you get everything back in recovery. That's an example of it.
But you know what? For as many times as he's tried, I've never seen him look this good. There he comes. There he comes now. Right? So smoking's the only vice left, right?
I tell you, you can't give up everything.
No vaping, though. Vaping's not good.
No, you know, I sold a minor an e-cigarette they got me for statutory vape. That's one of my new current event jokes. Now,
day 12 in the rehab right, center, mighty drill.
it's funny. You talk about getting stuff back in recovery. Again, my career never totally abandoned me, but my health was gone, man. Everything, you stop putting poison in your body. You know, who would have thunk it? You get better physically. Like, my diabetes is better. There's a great doctor in the Essex County Jail, Dr. A, and this sounds like a loser statement, but every time I go to Essex County Jail, he takes care of me. He gets me an egg carton.
Request
mattress.
Him.
Yeah, right, I do request him. It's funny, there's this nurse, this black woman, this nurse who was a doll there, but I didn't think she remembered me from the last time I was there. She took my blood sugar. Mm-hmm. And it was like 98. I go, that's pretty good. She goes, better than last time. I'm like, oh, you do remember me. That's sweet. But if you're a diabetic in jail, they get you up every day at 5 a.m. They wake you up in your cell, and you go take your blood sugar. And he goes, after like 3 weeks, I was there a month this last time. He goes, we're going to stop doing it. He goes, I don't know what you did, but you reversed diabetes. And I stopped doing drugs. I got healthier.
Yeah,
in recovery, so yeah.
It makes it work. You know, it turns it the opposite way, and it gives you more incentive to stay clean.
Yeah. No, I mean, obviously, I didn't think when I first went into the rooms, it was court ordered because I got arrested in Los Angeles in the 90s for possession of coke, and I took a big drunken swing at a cop, and I completely missed him. Thank God. It was like assault on a cop. So I was in L.A. County Jail, and if you would have told me at 28, that was 28 at that point, if you would have told me, you know, in 1996, something about 2019, I would have said, that's like a Jetsons episode. I would say to you, I'm not going to be here, man. I'm running too fast. I'm not going to be here in 2019. Why care about it?
Yeah.
And I never cared about it, but now I do. I want to be alive for a long time. I feel good.
And we do. And all your fans do.
Yeah.
And we want you around. You kicked ass Saturday night in Atlantic City.
Yeah.
I know, like, the Post wrote a review. I wrote a review for 101.5 for our website. Oh, that's
great. Yeah, you guys are very nice to me. Yeah. Now, the crowd was great. It was 2 sold-out shows.
Yeah.
The Late Show, I did an hour in about 5 minutes. It was great.
And the love that was pouring for you. Yeah. But I got, you did allude to the fact that the lines of communication are open now between you and Howard?
Well, I got to tell you, he was very nice to me through the press when his book came out. And I was pumping gas at an Exxon station.
Reading his book.
Yeah, reading the book. I'm reading interviews I did with the President of the United States with Howard in a book. And someone goes, hey, fill it up with regular. my crazy life. But he in every interview where they brought up my name, he was like, you know, I feel for Artie. And I gotta say this too. Howard's been very sweet, and he kind of alluded to the fact that he might have some guilt over what happened. He should have no guilt. All Howard did was try to help me. All he did was give me the best job ever, and I take full responsibility. He had no choice but to let me go. I was gonna die. And he tried to get me help. He got me into rehab a couple of times, and I would leave. And my crazy life, he was in my crazy life. And I don't think he knew what to do after a while. When a junkie is in your life and you care about them, you know, they start to rip your heart out. So Howard, I love him. He did nothing but help me. And he's got no reason to feel any guilt, you know.
Would you ever go back there? Would you ever go back to morning radio?
I don't know about morning radio.
That's what I mean, because after what you said, it did to you.
And well, you know, I mean, look, if I could, I want to get it before I make any decision that I have, like, where I have a schedule that's insane. I would want a year clean. Like I said, I got 8 months. I don't want to rush anything. The lifestyle, I'm going back on the road. I got a podcast I'm going to do called Artie Lang's Halfway House. It's going to start in a few weeks.
Excellent.
You know, that's an easier schedule. You know, I saw Howard is the reason I think me and Howard were entertaining was because he's probably the most disciplined human being on the planet sitting next to the most undisciplined. You know,
Oscar. Oh,
right, exactly. Live with your pots, your pans, your ladles, you meet them up. And if you ever want to ring a bell, we were the odd couple. That's why it worked. But and I respect how disciplined he was. If I get a year clean, God willing, and it's one day at a time, maybe I would certainly love to go back as a guest on the show if he was into it, but I have to reach out for him. I'm gonna give him a call and we'll see what happens.
You could see in his interviews, you know, that he really loves you. That he, you know, there's something there that it really hurt him. Like when you read like the New York Times piece,
I feel terrible about that because the ones you like, Kevin will tell you, you know, the ones you love suffer as much. As my mother said something else deep. My mom said, when you're in jail, it's like I'm in jail. Mm-hmm. And Howard had to sit next to me every morning, and the other people, you know, Robin is such a sweetheart. Freddie Norris is a genius, and he was my good friend there. And they're watching me, you know, die on the air almost. It's crazy.
Have you heard from any of them? Anybody else connected with the show?
I did a podcast for a guy who used to work there, Grillo, today, and mm-hmm. Timmy Sabian, who was the...
Sabian's the best.
Sabian's my favorite. I saw Timmy today.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah. So I talked to them. And Dougie Goodstein and some of the guys. I'm, you know, Casey Armstrong. I love all those guys.
I worked with Tim for 5 years at YSP.
Yeah.
My God.
That was classic radio. When Howard in the morning, you know, people don't realize Philly's the first town Howard syndicated in. Mm-hmm. In some ways, you know, because Howard, I was glad Howard did America's Got Talent because he got to do the road and see what he created.
Yeah.
He would see the love in every city. I would do stand up on the road. I'd say, Howard, you got to see what, like St. Louis. I mean, we were on all over the country and in Canada. And, you know, like I said, that woman who called, I was selling out San Francisco, 3,000 miles away, just talking into a microphone. Howard created that. Philly, man, was maybe bigger than any market we had.
Oh, yeah. MMA, it was the first one.
Yeah.
And I was there from the beginning. You
right.
know, doing the updates. And, you know, the first time he came down, like for the parade or with the books, it was so, like, lines going all the way up for blocks on South Street. Remember Jay Leno walked in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Get to see what was going on.
I understand how it's feeling. Let me tell you. I try to teach young comics how to do certain impressions. Here's how you do a Jay Leno impression. You talk really high with a lisp, and then out of nowhere, you deepen your voice. You're like, yes, I understand you're dating somebody. How's that going? Yes, I understand you're dating Justin Timberlake. How's that going?
1-800-283-101.5. Artie's in the house. It's 9:30. You don't have to worry about this when you podcast, right?
Again, like I said, because I was on the biggest radio show ever, I don't know how to do radio. Howard did none of this. He just didn't care.
Like, tell me about it. We had to play the commercials and follow him with the big basket for the poop. Okay, is he going to go now? No, not yet.
Oh, no. Absolutely. He just did what he wanted. And then, you know, we were supposed to be off at 10. He would go at 11, 11:30. That's when you got that kind of power.
When the breaks would come. God forbid, because they had a New York feed, right?
Yeah.
K-Rock run the commercials.
Yeah.
And then down to YSP, we had to match. So we had to wait for them to go into a break and then play our commercials. And God forbid, if Sabian ever heard 923 K-Rock, there'd be hell to pay.
Oh, because it was Philly,
You got to get that. That cannot be on the air.
Yeah, the Howard, again, it was rock and roll. People forget what radio... Yeah, this is real radio, what you do. This is real radio.
Yeah, we're stuck with elements.
You got to hit posts, breaks, weather... You know, because radio was information before entertainment, you know, but now it's both.
And Kevin Mir is with us from City of Angels, the founder, the CEO. We were talking during the break, and you had a great question for Artie.
Oh, yeah. So, well, first, I just want to say, you know, Artie, a couple times tonight you said, you know, I shouldn't be here.
Right.
But in this tough world, when you're on stage, you give people that moment of laugh. You provide them some happiness.
I hope.
Think of it. But one of the things we were just wondering is when you're in rehab and you're starting your recovery and you're kind of reflecting, were you ever thinking, wow, will I still have it when I get out? Am I going to be?
Yeah, that's always, you know, I've had 52 comebacks right now, and this feels the best because, like I say, I somehow made it to this age and I'm calmer. But you always say to yourself, can I do it? Like George Carlin used to say that a lot. It's funny, when I was in jail, my lawyer, Mike Robbins, great guy, he sent me a lot of reading material on top of writing I was reading. And I read a great article George Carlin did for Playboy in like 1982. And he was talking about coming off of cocaine, the fact that he got off of cocaine. And, you know, he talked about how terrible that drug is. And it is just terrible. I mean, cocaine and heroin, there's nothing good about it at all. But when you do, it lies to you. Drugs lie to you. They say, you need me, you know, you need me to do anything. So when you're a performer and you're on stage, you go, do I need to be high? Do I need to, and without question, I'm a million times better straight. I'm a million times better not high.
What's it like being up there? Like now, like when you did the show Sunday night, Saturday in Atlantic City, what was it like being up there not high? Just being able to think and coherently appreciate what was happening to you?
Well, as long as the audience is high, they'll laugh. Yeah, right. It doesn't have to be me. I always say it's like I can't get drunk anymore. I hope women still get drunk so I can have sex. I tell you what, there's a rush. Again, if you're a performer, you get this. It's funny, when I told you, you know, Bruce Springsteen, who just turned 70, there's a, you know, story I tell in one of my books. He called me once, and he shared with me a lot of amazing things when he called me on the phone. This was back in 2010, and he talked to me for like an hour and a half, and he goes, "How you doing, man?" And the Bruce talk, and he knew he was one of my heroes, and it helped me out a lot. And he said, you know, I never had a real problem with heavy drugs, but I knew a lot of guys. You talked about Neil Young and people he helped get clean. And I thought that was amazing, because Quincy Jones did the same thing with me with Miles Davis and Charlie Parker when I was on Mad TV. Quincy produced that show, and Quincy was like a second dad to me back then. And he goes, "Yeah, man, you a funny cat, man. You know, Miles Davis was screwed up, you know." And I'm like, you know, I'm a guy who just loaded trucks. So Bruce is talking to me about Neil Young and stuff, and I said to him, I go, "Dude, when you're up there, you know, and you get that energy from the crowd, because that is a buzz. That's like a high. It's like a hit of heroin, man. When you get that energy." I would say to him, "How do you come down?" And because seeing him, I've seen him all over the world. I saw him in Paris. You know, people know his songs in French. That's a high.
Yeah.
That's a high. 4 hours of him singing these songs, this electricity, an hour of stand-up, I get it. I said, you didn't have problems with drugs. How did you come down from that? And he goes, "Well, I'm a big reader." I'm like, "Well, so am I." But that didn't work after a while. Some people just have the discipline to just, they cannot go there. Some people aren't addicts. There really are there is that thing, I guess, where, you know, the disease part, they call it the ism part of alcoholism, whatever, mm-hmm. is some people can put it down. Some people can put it down knowing the consequences. I kept picking up drugs after shows to try to come down, to try to keep that high going, because I guess I have that ism. I have that disease part where I gotta keep it going. And no matter what the consequences are, you will get high. Jail, prison, health, you know, women leaving you, your family leaving you, your friends leaving you. And he told me, he said, he goes, you gotta get spiritual. Like, you know, and that's what everybody in NAAA, it's not a religious program. They tell you it's a spiritual program. You gotta have some sort of spiritual awakening to where you say, I don't need this anymore. The high I get on stage is enough. A human being doesn't have to be high all the time. You know, right. There's times you don't feel good. You have human emotions. The problem with heroin, the withdrawals come back. Not only are they physical, all the emotional pain that you're masking comes back like a tsunami.
How about that?
And the depression comes back. So you're dealing with cramps and throwing up and puking and everything. And also all this depression that comes back, because you're also masking that emotional pain. You got to let yourself feel something. So I feel on stage. I get it on stage. I love it. And then you got to just try to come down, go to sleep naturally, and be a human being.
What happened when you got off stage in Atlantic City then? Like now you're doing a show and you're not high anymore.
I keep moving. You wait around, you get your check. That's a high. You get paid to do something you love.
Finding the club owner's a high.
Oh, well, yeah. Well, you get paid way more. Well, I'm saying, I mean, a counselor finally sat me down and said, "When are you going to get grateful? When the F are you going to get grateful for what you have? People don't have this. You go back to something you love."
You always seem grateful to me, though.
Well, humble. You know, if you're doing drugs on a level I was doing and going to jail and having these consequences, it doesn't show gratitude. It shows like you're taking it for granted. And I got arrogant, even though I never seemed to. You get arrogant, your ego gets stroked all the time, man, and you feel like a rock star. But I got off stage, I got paid, I settled down. I took a shower in my hotel room. I got my car. I put the radio on. I put Backstreets on by Springsteen.
There you go.
And and the Stones and all these guys I love. And I drove home with the window open and a cigarette. That's what I do now. You know, and listen, here's the other thing. I can't put pressure on myself as an addict. Kevin will tell you this, dealing with addicts. I can't guarantee everybody. I can't put pressure. I can't guarantee you I'm never going to get high again. I'm pretty sure between now, right now, and the walk to the car, I'm not going to get high. And then you put little 5-minute pieces together, they become days, and then you get time. you get time. I can't guarantee you I'm not going to get high tomorrow. But today, I'm pretty sure I'm not going to get high. And that's all I can guarantee you.
And we're all pulling for you. 1-800-283-101.5. Stick around. Artie is. New Jersey
101.5. At Levinson Axelrod, we've been helping injured riders for over 80 years. We've seen the sorrow when an injured rider can no longer lift a child in their arms or participate in a simple game of catch. At Levinson Axelrod, we'll work to get the compensation you need to replace the everyday joys that are lost forever. Call us today. We were here for you yesterday. We're here for you today. And we'll be there for you tomorrow. Levinson Axelrod, when you need justice.
A routine is a good thing to have. And sometimes a routine is a good thing to break. Take a break and start your morning at McDonald's with a hot and savory breakfast. For a limited time, get our new chicken McGriddles or a tasty sausage McGriddles for only $2 each. Because if you don't deserve a morning that's a little easier and a lot tastier, who does? Price and participation may vary, cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Come help a great cause at the 3rd Annual Nicholas Houdanish Rock for Awareness Festival, sponsored by Jersey Mike Subs at Community Park in Point Pleasant, starting at noon on Saturday, September 28th, with two of the Jersey Shore's best bands, The Nerds and The Surge. Bring lawn chairs, enjoy food trucks, over 50 vendors, pony rides, petting zoo, and free admission. Proceeds will go to the Nicholas Houdanish Foundation, which provides drug and behavioral health education and curriculum to local high schools to help prevent addiction. Don't miss the 3rd Annual Rock for Awareness Festival, September 28th in Point Pleasant.
Hello, I'm Dr. Jonty Shaban, board-certified pediatric neurologist at K. Hovannisian Children's Hospital in Neptune. As school approaches, I want to encourage parents to reduce the length of time child spends on electronics, maintain proper sleep, not skip meals, eat a balanced diet, and stay hydrated. Physical activities and meditation provide balance of mind and body to decrease headaches for children. To learn more about neurological conditions treated, please visit us at khovannisianchildrenshospital.com/neurology.
Log on to the Insider drop-down page on NJ1015.com to become a New Jersey Insider for a chance to win great prizes. Sponsored by Hackensack Meridian Health. Our listeners have the chance to win tickets to shows and sporting events, the latest techno gear, retail gift cards, and more. Earn chances to win by clicking on the Hackensack Meridian flashcards and learn about an array of exclusive health and lifestyle information, from healthy recipes to wellness tips and more. The prize club is courtesy of Hackensack Meridian Health and New Jersey 101.5. Tuned into health, we are life years ahead.
Let me ask you a question. How do you feel about genetically modified ingredients?
Don't like them.
Artificial flavors and colors?
No thanks.
Clean ingredients.
Now that I like.
When you care about what's in things and what's not, shouldn't your vitamins be clean too? Sundown Vitamins are all clean all the time. Non-GMO, free of gluten and dairy, with colors and flavors from real food. We even have USDA certified Sundown Organics and kids vitamins too. When you're living clean, choose clean with Sundown Vitamins at supermarkets, drugstores, or on Amazon.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans. 30% of Americans who are planning home improvements of $5,000 or more will pay for those renovations with a high-interest credit card. That may not be a great idea. A better idea may be to take cash out of your home with a Quicken Loans 30-year fixed-rate mortgage. The rate today on our 30-year fixed-rate mortgage is 4.125%. APR, 4.22%. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
Rate subject to change. 8.88% fee to receive this discounted rate. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Using an overpriced trash bag?
Pricey, pricey, pricey!
A bag that breaks?
Whippy, whippy, whippy!
Or a smelly bag?
Stinky, stinky, stinky!
Time to switch to Hefty Ultra Strong Trash Bags. Always at an ultra low price.
Hefty, hefty, hefty!
They're our best bags yet. And they cost less than Glad Force Flex, where sold head to head. So you'll be...
happy, happy, happy!
Hefty Ultra Strong with Arm & Hammer Odor Control. Also available in heavy-duty black bags.
Hefty, hefty, hefty!
1-800-283-101.5. I'm Steve Trevelise. Here's New Jersey 101.5 Fast Traffic.
That road work on the Turnpike Extension, slowing the ride on the westbound side across the Newark Bay Bridge, 14A in toward 14, you are single file with that construction, and it looks like we are really slowing down northbound on the main line of the Turnpike, approaching the eastern and western split. It looks like they're closing either the eastern or the western spur going northbound, so we'll definitely keep an eye on that. Eastbound 78 in the express lane, some road work approaching exit 58 in Newark slows your ride, and you've also got some work on the parkway, southbound over the Driscoll Bridge. Now, Route 35, some road work in South Amboy is heavy south into Ernston Road and also northbound in Middletown. Some construction delays on 35 between Chapel Hill Road and Kings Highway East. Crossing the Hudson, George Washington Bridge, leaving New Jersey is fine. Lincoln Tunnel about 15 minutes on 495 East. Over at the Holland, traffic is pretty quiet for the time being. And crossing the Delaware, watch out for road work each way over at the Burlington-Bristol Bridge. 195 West, exit 11 in Upper Freehold. That accident has been cleared from the ramp. And this report sponsored by the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation. Use your power to cure IBS and join the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation at Spin 4 Crohn's and Colitis Cures. Get started at spin4.org. Traffic every 15 minutes. Nick Shapore, 10:03. I'm H. Torres on New Jersey 101.5.
New Jersey 101.5 instant weather. Looks to be on the mild side the next several days. Maybe a couple raindrops along the way, but mostly dry. We'll see a mainly clear sky tonight, lows in the low 60s. Clouds and sunshine on Thursday, a small chance of late day showers, a high in the low 80s. And sunny weather returning Friday, mid-70s. The weekend, highs in the 70s. A few small showers possible Saturday. Dry on Sunday. I'm meteorologist Mark Thibodeau.
Okay, we've got, don't tell me, 61 degrees in Jamesburg, 60 degrees West Milford, 67 degrees Tinton Falls, fast traffic, instant weather every 15 minutes on New Jersey 101.5. Artie Lange is in the house.
Under pressure.
Kevin Mira is here.
Present.
The great Kevin Mira.
The great Kevin Mira. CEO, co-founder, City
Can
of Angels.
Tape that and send it to my wife.
Yeah, really.
Yeah.
It was
only 10 months ago that you came in here and we were all together.
Right.
And you announced you were going into rehab.
Yeah.
Now look at you.
Well, again, like I say, I got to give the retreat props. The retreat got me off of heroin.
Yep.
When I the cocaine was a see, that's where I know I'm a drug addict, man, because I got heroin out of my life. Jail was a consequence. And I said, well, I could. And then someone says to me, I started to get the shots of Suboxone, which somehow weaned me off it. I don't know. I mean, I haven't had Suboxone in months either. I'm totally clean now. Totally clean. Nothing.
God,
I mean,
that
really is like, I don't have any medication in me. Nothing. You can't have anything on drug court anyway. I mean, right. You can't have a Benadryl. But, Kev came to court and advocated for me, and he said, the heroin's gone. It's progress. And I thank you for helping me to get into the retreat. And then, it took me 8 months to really get everything out of my life. You know?
We were sitting there outside of court one day, and I said, Artie, you want to hear something funny? And he kind of looked at me and laughed like, I'm not the comedian here. But I said, you know what? If you were an alcoholic, you wouldn't be here right now.
Right.
Because it's legal. Because it's legal.
Yep. Now, that's our crazy system. I got to tell you, man, the people who are strictly alcoholics have been drinking nonstop for 20 years. I got to tell you, man, they look worse than some drug addicts. I mean, it's all a lie. Mm-hmm. Now weed's going to be like having a glass of wine pretty soon. Yeah. You know, there's too much money.
Oh, absolutely.
You're talking about, they have not, you talk about a business venture. Wall Street has not even put their tippy toe into the water of the weed business yet. They have not done that. When it goes public, it's going to be insane. They're going to make what the dealers were making. Gambling, another vice.
Look at sports betting. There's so they never expected that much money.
Oh, forget
would come in when they started, with the sports betting.
Yeah.
I did an interview with Albert Chen from Sport. He's a senior editor for Sports Illustrated.
Right, right.
Wrote a book called Billion Dollar Fantasy, and it's the story of FanDuel and DraftKings.
Yeah, yeah.
And you would think like these big football experts or gambling guys started. A couple of nerds in Scotland.
Right.
Guy and his wife.
That's
and,
all.
In Boston, a couple of nerds.
Startups like that. Yeah.
And she's making $10 million deals. While the kids are in Harry Potter land. It was an amazing story. And you look at what happened, how big it got.
Bookies are always going to make money on some level because you don't have to lay out the cash with a bookie. That's what's so scary about a book. With legal gambling, you got to go and you got to give them the money.
Give me the credit card. Yeah,
right, exactly.
Yeah, we got you.
But with a bookie, you call Bacchagaloop in Staten Island.
Him too.
I dealt with a lot of those guys, and you had a number and a nickname. I was Gabagool for 37. you went back in the 80s, waiting on a pay phone. What's the line on a Redskin game? Blah blah blah. You could just say, give me $5,000 on a game, mm-hmm. and before you know it, if you lose, now Bacchagaloop's after you with a bat, and you owe him $5,000. With the legal guys,
the payment plan was very dangerous.
But the VIG is 27%. which is 3% more than the books were charging. The books were like 24, 25. It's 27% the government's charging. So they're going to make insane money. Prohibition with Al Capone. They're like, why are we letting Al Capone make all the money?
Yeah.
You know?
Sports betting in Jersey. Just
right.
Tap in. It's weird.
Well, I mean, listen, again, I think most people are, heroin, I hate to say this, is very available. It's all over the place. Mm-hmm. It's all, if you know what you're doing, if you know how to move and you know dealers, you could get it like you buy alcohol. You could get it. I think most smart people who aren't addicts aren't going to do it anyway. Why not tax it? Why tax it and make all that money? People are going to do it anyway. If you're going to allow liquor,
other countries do it.
Of course.
And why not? You know, just make it all legal. You make your own decisions.
Look at Amsterdam. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
they don't care. They let adults be adults. The thing about this country found a way to make money off so-called, I want to save your life. What do you want to save my life for? If I'm not hurting somebody else, let me do what I'm going to do. If I'm not mature.
Country.
Yeah, I mean, you know what? Tax it, make money, and I don't know, feed the poor. You could feed every poor starving child on the planet with the tax on blow. Are you kidding me?
Absolutely. Hey, you got to get out of here. We have to see that
Steve,
happen.
Steve, let me tell you something. I love you so much. Thank you for everything. I will be back soon. I got to go do my thing. I got to get up tomorrow. Kevin, thank you so much, buddy.
Yes, sir.
To everyone in the audience, thank you. To Judy Franco, Dennis, everybody here at the 101.5 family. I'm gonna book a gig in Philly. Steve's going to be involved, and I'll be back soon enough. Thank you, Steve.
Love you, too.
I love you, buddy.
See you soon.
All right? Take care.